This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Harvard Crimson, the daily student newspaper of Harvard University, was founded in 1873. It is the only daily newspaper in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and is run entirely by Harvard College undergraduates. Many Crimson alumni have gone on to careers in journalism, and some have won Pulitzer Prizes. Contents 1 about the Crimson 2 History 21 Early Years 22 20th Century 23 Postwar Growth 24 Modern Day Paper 3 Notable Past Senior Members 4 Recent Presidents 5 Recent Managing Editors 6 publications from the staff of the Harvard Crimson 7 See also 8 references about the Crimson. The Harvard Crimson Office. Any student who volunteers and completes a series of requirements known as the Comp is elected an editor of the newspaper. Thus, all staff members of the Crimson, including writers, business staff, photographers, and graphic designers, are technically editors. If an editor makes news, he or she is referred to in the paper's news article as a Crimson editor, which, though important for transparency, also leads to characterizations such as former President John F. Kennedy, 40, who is also a Crimson editor, ended the Cuban Missile Crisis. Editorial and financial decisions rest in a board of executives, collectively called a guard, who are chosen for one-year terms each November by the outgoing guard. This process is referred to as the turkey shoot or the shoot. The unsigned opinions of the Crimson staff are decided at tri-weekly meetings that are open to any Crimson editor except those editors who plan to write or edit a news story on the same topic in the future. The Crimson is almost the only college newspaper in the U.S. that owns its own printing presses. At the beginning of 2004, the Crimson began publishing with a full-color front and back page. In conjunction with the launch of a major redesign, the Crimson also prints over 15 other publications on its presses. The Crimson has a rivalry with the Harvard Lampoon, which it refers to in print as a semi-secret Sorrento Square social organization that used to occasionally publish a so-called humor magazine. Young Rich Penn's book deal is one example of this running joke. Penning books in the humor category seems fitting because Rich, as the statement takes care to mention, is the president of the Harvard Lampoon, a semi-secret Sorrento Square social organization that used to occasionally publish a so-called humor magazine. The two organizations occupy buildings within less than one block of each other. Interaction between their staff has included pranks, vandalism, and even romance. Crimson alumni include Presidents John F. Kennedy of the class of 1940, who served as a business editor, and Franklin D. Roosevelt, who served as president of the newspaper. Class of 1904 writer Cleveland Amory was president of the Crimson. When Katharine Hepburn's mother asked him what he planned to do after college, he says he replied teasingly that once you had been president of the Harvard Crimson in your senior year at Harvard, there was very little, in afterlife, for you. Currently, the Crimson publishes two weekly pull-out sections in addition to its regular daily paper, an arts section on Tuesdays and a magazine called 15 Minutes on Thursdays. The Crimson is a non-profit organization that is independent of the university. All decisions on the content and day-to-day operations of the newspaper are made by undergraduates. The student leaders of the newspaper employ several non-student staff, many of whom have stayed on for many years and have come to be thought of as family members by the students who run the paper. History. Early years. The Harvard Crimson was one of many college newspapers founded shortly after the Civil War and describes itself as the nation's oldest continuously published daily college newspaper, although this description is contested by other college newspapers. The Yale Daily News, published daily since its 1878 founding except for breaks during World War I and II, calls itself the oldest college daily. The Columbia Daily Spectator, founded in 1877, claims to be the second oldest college daily. The Brown Daily Herald, established in 1866 and daily since 1891, claims to be the second oldest college newspaper and fifth oldest college daily. The Cornell Daily Sun, launched in 1880, claims to be the oldest independent college newspaper. The Dartmouth of Dartmouth College, which opened in 1843 as a monthly, calls itself the oldest college newspaper, though not the oldest daily, and makes a claim to institutional continuity with a local 18th-century paper called the Dartmouth Gazette. The Crimson traces its origin to the first issue of the Magenta, published January 24, 1873. Despite strong discouragement from the dean, the faculty of the college had suspended the existence of several previous student newspapers, including the Collegian, whose motto Dulce et periculum, sweet and dangerous, represented the precarious place of the student press at Harvard University in the late 19th century. The Magenta's editors declined Dean Burney's advice and moved forward with a biweekly paper, a thin layer of editorial content surrounded by an even thinner wrapper of advertising. The paper changed its name to the Crimson in 1875 when Harvard changed its official color by a vote of the student body. The announcement came with a full-page editorial announcing, "Magenta is not now, and." This and the editorial board brought the paper to become, in essence, the modern Crimson. The newspaper's president no longer authored editorials single-handedly, and the paper took stronger editorial positions. The 1930s and 1940s were dark years for the Crimson. Reduced financial resources and competition from a publication established by ex-editors meant serious challenges to the paper's viability. In 1943, the banner on the paper read Harvard Service News, and the stories focused almost exclusively on Harvard's contribution to the war effort under the authority of so-called wartime administrative necessity. Alumni discouraged the Service News from editorializing. The paper was administered during the war by a board of university administrators, alumni, and students. In 1934, the Crimson defended a proposal by Adolf Hitler's press secretary, Ernst F. Sedgwick Hamstangel, to donate to Harvard a prize scholarship to enable a Harvard student to attend a Nazi university. The Harvard Corporation voted unanimously to refuse the offer. "We are unwilling to accept a gift from one who has been so closely identified with the leadership of a political party which has inflicted damage on the universities of Germany through measures which have struck at principles we believe to be fundamental to universities throughout the world." The Crimson defended it, that political theories should prevent a Harvard student from enjoying an opportunity for research in one of the world's greatest cultural centers as most unfortunate and scarcely in line with the liberal traditions of which Harvard is pardonably proud. Post-war growth. The paper went back to its civilian version in 1946, and as the Army and Navy moved out of Harvard, the Crimson grew larger, more financially secure, more diversified, and more aware of the world outside the campus during the early Cold War era than its pre-World War II predecessor had been. The paper, although financially independent and independent of editorial control by the Harvard University Administration, was under the university's administrative control insofar as it was composed of university students who were subject to the university's rules. Radcliffe women on staff were forced to follow curfews to which Harvard men were not subject, and that interfered greatly with the late hours required in producing a newspaper throughout the 1950s. The Crimson and various university officials exchanged letters debating these restrictions. Crimson editors pushed for later curfews for their female writers, who grew increasingly important in day-to-day operations under President Philip Cronin. 53. Women became staff members rather than Radcliffe correspondents. Crimson writers were involved in national issues, especially when anti-communist investigative committees came to Harvard. Future Pulitzer Prize-winning writer Anthony Lucas. Stories most notably, an interview with HUAC witness Wendell H. Furry were sometimes picked up by the Associated Press. Not even a staff writer yet, Lucas had arrived at the university with Joseph McCarthy's home number in his pocket. His father was an opponent of McCarthy's and a member of the American Jewish Committee, the group that produced commentary magazine modern-day paper. The Harvard Crimson, Inc. was incorporated as a non-profit Massachusetts corporation in 1966. The incorporation was involuntarily revoked, then revived, in 1986. In 1991, student reporters for the Crimson were the first to break the news that Harvard had selected former Princeton provost Neil Leon Rudenstein to succeed Derek Bok as president of the university. The reporters, who had learned of a secret meeting in New York, got their confirmation when they approached a surprised Rudenstein on his plane ride back to Boston. The story appeared in an extra bearing the Dateline somewhere over New England. Crimson editors repeated the scoop in 2001, beating out national media outlets to report that Lawrence Summers would succeed Rudenstein, and again in 2007, being the first to report Drew Gilpin Faust's ascension to the presidency. Throughout the 1990s, there was a great deal of focus on making the staff of the paper more inclusive and diverse over time. A financial aid program was instituted to try to address the problem of a lack of socioeconomic diversity today. Some 90 editors participate in the financial aid program every semester. On January 12, 2004, the Crimson printed its first color edition after obtaining and installing four new Goss Community color presses. The date also marked the unveiling of a major redesign of the paper itself. In 2004, the Crimson filed a lawsuit against Harvard University to force the Harvard University Police Department to release more complete records to the public. The case was heard before the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court in November 2005. In January 2005, 2006, the court decided the case in favor of the university in November 2005. The Crimson had its records subpoenaed by Connect2, a firm suing Facebook. Its better-known competitor, the Crimson, challenged the subpoena and said that it would not comply with Connect2's demands for documents on April 23, 2006. The Crimson was the first to allege that portions of Harvard student Kavya Viswanathan's highly publicized debut young adult novel How Opal Mehta Got Kissed, Got Wild, and Got a Life had been plagiarized from two best-selling books by novelist Megan McCafferty. Further allegations were later made that Viswanathan's novel had drawn inappropriately from other novels as well, notable past senior members George Abrams, lawyer and businessman, Daniel Altman, author and journalist Cleveland Amory, writer Eli Addy, speechwriter and screenwriter Steve Ballmer, former CEO of Microsoft Stephen Barnett 1935-2009, legal scholar at University of California, Berkeley School of Law who opposed the Newspaper Preservation Act of 1970, Michael Barone, television commentator, senior writer for U.S. News. Richard Connell, author Jim Cramer, host of CNBC's Mad Money Michael Crichton, author Robert Detchard, CEO of A.H. Bellow Corporation E.J. Dionne Jr., columnist for The Washington Post Esther Dyson, digital technology analyst, author Daniel Ellsberg, author, released the Pentagon Papers Garrett Epps, author and law school professor James Fallows, journalist Susan Faludi, author David Frankel, filmmaker V.V. Ganeshananthan, author and journalist Mark Guerin, former Peace Corps director James Glassman, journalist, diplomat, and director of the George W. Bush Institute. George Goodman, a.k.a. Adam Smith, hosted the Emmy Award-winning program Adam Smith's Money World on PBS. Donald E. Graham, CEO and chairman of the Washington Post. Co-C. Boyden Gray, Committee for Justice chairman and White House counsel to President George H. W. Bush. Linda Greenhouse, journalist for The New York Times. David Halberstam, author Hendrik Hertzberg, journalist for The New Yorker. David Ignatius, columnist for The Washington Post. Boyce Fouye Jones Jr., publisher and CEO of The Washington Post. Peter Kaplan, former editor-in-chief of The New York Observer, current creative director of Condé Nast. Traveler Caroline Kennedy, U.S. ambassador to Japan and daughter of U.S. President John F. Kennedy. John F. Kennedy, 35th President of the United States. Mickey Cause, journalist and political blogger Michael Kinsley, journalist, founding editor of Slate magazine. Peter Kramer, psychiatrist, author Nicholas D. Kristof, columnist for The New York Times. Thomas Samuel Kuhn, philosopher and historian of science. Charles Lane, former editor of The New Republic. Jennifer Ait Lee, journalist for The New York Times. Nicholas LeMann, Dean of the Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism. Anthony Lewis, author and former columnist for The New York Times. Arthur Lubo, journalist. J. Anthony Lucas, author and Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. Michael McCobe, New York Times best-selling author and psychoanalyst. Charles S. Mayer, professor of history at Harvard. James S. Marcus, investment banker and philanthropist. Bill McKibben, environmentalist, author Grover Norquist, president of Americans for Tax Reform. Mark Penn, chief political strategist for Hillary Clinton's 2008 presidential campaign. Frank Rich, columnist for The New York Times. Stephen V. Roberts, former reporter for The New York Times, television journalist. Franklin D. Roosevelt, 32nd President of the United States. Scott Rosenberg, co-founder of Salon.com. Jack Rosenthal, journalist for The New York Times and president of the New York Times Company Foundation. David Sanger, journalist for The New York Times. Nell Scovell, creator of Sabrina, the teenage witch TV series. Robert Ellis Smith, noted journalist and creator of the privacy journal Whit Stillman, filmmaker Ira Stoll, New York Sun executive Paul Sweezy, Marxist economist and funder of the monthly review Katrina Sish, television personality Evan Thomas, associate managing editor of Newsweek P. Jeffrey Toobin, senior legal analyst for CNN Craig Unger, author and journalist Andrew Weil, alternative medicine advocate George Weller, novelist, playwright, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist for The New York Times and the Chicago Daily News. Casper Weinberger, United States Secretary of Defense under President Ronald Reagan. Mark Whitaker, Senior Vice President of NBC News, former editor of Newsweek. Elizabeth Wurtzel, author Jeff Zucker, former President and CEO of NBC Universal, now head of CNN. Recent presidents. Mariel A. Klein, 17-143 Road Guard Spring and Fall 2016. Stephen S. Lee, 16-142 ND Guard Spring and Fall 2015. Samuel Y. Weinstock, 15-141 Street Guard Spring and Fall 2014. Robert S. Samuels, 14-140 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2013. E. Benjamin Samuels, 13-139 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2012. Naveen N. Srivasta, 12-138 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2011. Peter F. Zhu, 11-137 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2010. Maxwell L. Child, 10-136 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2009. Malcolm A. Glenn, 09-135 Guard Spring and Fall 2008. Christina M. Moore, 08-134 Guard Spring and Fall 2007. William C. Mara, 07-133 Guard Spring and Fall 2006. Lauren A. E. Shooker, 06-132 Guard Spring and Fall 2005. Erica K. Jalli, 05-131 Guard Spring and Fall 2004. Ahmed R. Paley, 04-130 Guard Spring and Fall 2003. Imtiaz H. Delawala, 03-129 Guard Spring and Fall 2002. C. Matthew McInnes, 02-128 Guard Spring and Fall 2001. Alan E. Werbitsky, 01-127 Guard Spring and Fall 2000. Joshua H. Simon, 00-126 Guard Spring and Fall 1999. Matthew W. Grenade, 99-125 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1998. Joshua J. Shanker, 98-124 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1997. Todd F. Bronstein, 97-123 Road Guard Spring and Fall 1996. Andrew L. Wright, 96-122 ND Guard Spring and Fall 1995. Marion B. Gamill, 95-121 Street Guard Spring and Fall 1994. Ira E. 94-120 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1993. Julian E. Barnes, 93-119 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1992. Rebecca L. Walkowitz, 92-118 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1991. Jonathan S. Cohn, 91-117 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1990. Recent Managing Editors Meg P. Bernhardt, 17-143 Road Guard Spring and Fall 2016. Madeline R. Conway, 16-142 ND Guard Spring and Fall 2015. Nicholas P. Fandos, 15-141 Street Guard Spring and Fall 2014. Rebecca D. Robbins, 14-140 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2013. Julie M. Zosmer, 13-139 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2012. Elias J. Grohl, 12-138 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2011. Esther I. Yee, 11-137 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2010. Clifford M. Marks, 10-136 TH Guard Spring and Fall 2009. Paris D. Bayani, 09-135 Guard Spring and Fall 2008. Javier C. Hernandez, 08-134 Guard Spring and Fall 2007. Daniel J. Hemmel, 07-133 Guard Spring and Fall 2006. Zachary M. Seward, 07-09-133 Guard January 2006. Stephen M. Marks, 06-132 Guard Spring and Fall 2005. Elizabeth S. Theodore, 05-131 Guard Spring and Fall 2004. David H. Gellis, 04-130 Guard Spring and Fall 2003. Daniela J. Lamas, 03-129 Guard Spring and Fall 2002. Vasugi V. Ganeshananthan, 02-128 Guard Fall 2001. Parker R. Conrad, 02-128 Guard Spring 2001. Rosalind S. Helderman, 01-127 Guard Spring and Fall 2000. Georgia N. Alexakis, 00-126 Guard Spring and Fall 1999. Andrew S. Chong, 99-125 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1998. Valerie J. McMillan, 98, and Andrew A. Green, 98-124 TH Guard Spring and Fall 1997. Publications from the staff of the Harvard Crimson. 55 Successful Harvard Law School Application Essays, 2nd Edition, What Worked for Them Can Help You Get Into the Law School of Your Choice, by the staff of the Harvard Crimson, St. Martin's Griffin, 2014. 50 Successful Harvard Application Essays, 3rd Edition, What Worked for Them Can Help You Get into the College of Your Choice, by the staff of the Harvard Crimson, St. Martin's Griffin, 2010 How They Got into Harvard, 50 Successful Applicants Share 8 Key Strategies for Getting into the College of Your Choice, by the staff of the Harvard Crimson, St. Martin's Press, 2005 See also Harvard Law Record, the student newspaper of Harvard Law School Secret Court of 1920 References Carrot Brubacher, John S., Willis Rudy 1997 Higher Education in Transition Transaction Publishers ISBN. Harvard Advocate, use the term comp to refer to their training and selection process of new members. The term is often considered an abbreviation for competition, although Crimson editors say that their use of the word comp is an abbreviation for competency, emphasizing the training aspect of the comp. Carrot Harvard Crimson, February 1, 2006 Carrot Young Rich Land's Book Deal, The CrimsonCom retrieved 3 July 2015. 1911, when President Daniel Nugent, class of 1911, established a separate editorial board, which has been a key fixture in the Harvard and local Boston community ever since. To be perfectly honest, it should be said that even in 1911 the Crimson's higher executives had a much more influential voice when it came to staff editorials. By the mid-1930s, formal editorial meetings, open to the entire staff, were held regularly as they are today. 2009. 2015. Carrot Mark D. Guerin, The CrimsonCom retrieved 3 July 2015. http://dailynisuncom/repository/getfilesospstyle=olivexlib:article2mail. Carrot Scott Rosenberg, Crimson Reminiscence. Wordyard retrieved 3 July 2015. Carrot Adweek, Breaking News in Advertising, Media and Technology, Adweek retrieved 3 July 2015. Arts and Sciences. Leverett Lowell Mather Forsheimer Quincy Winthrop Undergraduate Organizations The Harvard Crimson The Harvard Lampoon The Harvard Advocate The Harvard Independent Athletics Harvard Crimson Ivy League Harvard Stadium Yale Football Rivalry Leviatus Pavilion Bright Hockey Center Cornell Hockey Rivalry Beanpot Weld Boathouse Newall Boathouse Continuing Education Division of Continuing Education Dean Huntington D. Lambert Extension School Summer School History of Harvard Extension School Eng. Libraries Cabot Harvard Yenching Houghton Harvard Review Lamont Pusey Widener Harry Widener Eleanor Elkins Widener Grossman. Nieman Foundation for Journalism Ukrainian Research Institute Villa I. Totti W.E.B. Du Bois Institute Business Harvard Business School Dean Nitin Noria Harvard Business Publishing Harvard Business Press Harvard Business Review Design Harvard Graduate School of Design Dean Mohsen Mostafavi Harvard Design Magazine Joint Center for Housing Studies Divinity Harvard Divinity School Dean David N. Hempton Education Harvard Graduate School of Education Government John F. Kennedy School of Government Dean Douglas Elmendorf Institute of Politics Law Harvard Law School Dean Martha Minow Harvard Law Review Harvard Journal of Law Harvard Medical School Dean Jeffrey Scott Flyer Broad Institute Countway Library Center for the History of Medicine Warren Anatomical Museum Shepin's Eye Research Institute Dentistry Harvard School of Dental Medicine Dean Bruce Donoff Public Health Harvard T. H. Chan School of Public Health Dean Julio Frank Museums Harvard Art Museums Arthur M. Sackler Fogg Museum Bush Reisinger Harvard Collection of Historical Scientific Instruments Museum of Natural History Glass Flowers Mineralogical Museum Herbaria Comparative Zoology Peabody Museum of Archaeology and Ethnology Semitic Museum General Artemis Ward House Cambridge Campus Memorial Hall Science Center Smith Campus Center Peabody Terrace Harvard Graduate Center Harvard Hall University Hall Memorial Church Choir Harvard Yard Johnston Gate Centers and Institutes Dumbarton Oaks Harvard Forest Health Science and Technology Institute for Advanced Theater Training Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study Schlesinger Library Real Colegio Complutense WIS Institute for Biologically Inspired Engineering MISC Commencement Traditions Academic Regalia Heraldry Tercentenary Celebration Harvard University Professor Harvard Magazine Harvard Gazette Harvard University Press Society of Fellows